Yes. So the lecture is on statistical analysis with ANOVA and PCA and preference mapping. So the outline of the talk is as follows. There will first be a kind of introductory part on one-way ANOVA. Then we go into ANOVA for preference data, and then to ANOVA with descriptive analysis. This will be rather briefly because you will have a lecture later with panel check where you see more on the practice around ANOVA for sensory data. Then we will go into multivariate analysis with principal component analysis and preference mapping. And finally, I will demonstrate how to do it in consumer check, and you will have the chance to do some practical exercises. I will try to have two breaks, approximately around these times, but it depends a bit on how far we get on the lecture. I will ask you to ask questions after the presentations, and you will also get the chance to ask questions just before the breaks, and then you can use the raise hand function or to ask in the chat. So first, the introductory part on one-way ANOVA. So the assumptions for ANOVA is that the data, or that is the residuals after an analysis, will be normally distributed. And you assume that we have the same spread for all treatments, which is called homogeneous variation. And we also assume that we have independent observations, so that we don't have any correlations between the random part of the models. So it can be illustrated as shown us on the right side, that you assume that you have two different type of treatments or groups, and you want to know if the means are different. And here it is shown with two examples where the difference between the means is the same, but the variability is different. So in the first case, you have an overlapping distribution. So you cannot really say that there is a difference between the means of these two distributions. Whereas in the lower situation, you have a smaller variation and you have a more separation between the means, and we can reject this hypothesis that these two distributions are the same. So these are the principles for the ANOVA. An analysis of variance, it's all about the variance, and it's also about to understand what sources of variation contribute the most. So we split the variation into different sources of origin. So in typical consumer and sensory and science, these are treatments or products or different design factors for the products. And you have consumers or trained assessors. In sensory analysis, you can also have replication or session effects. And we also have the random error, which is everything that is not systematic. And what we do in ANOVA is that we compare different variance estimates. So we compare ratios of variances. And this ratio is the variability between the different sources. And the main question is, if the variance between our treatments or products are large compared to the random error. So we want to know if we have a large systematic error compared to the random error. So here is a very illustrative example with a very similar data, simple data set with the three different, let's say, products and four different observations. So here it's kind of no different assessors or consumers. We have independent observations for each of them. We can illustrate the data with a plot like this, where these triangles represent the mean values and the red dots represent the single observations. Data can also be illustrated with box plots. I have to say that this is a bit artificial. We don't use box plots if we have four observations for each treatment, but it's just to illustrate the point. And here the size of the box and the difference location of the box will give an indication about your data. ANOVA, the one-way ANOVA is all about comparing the variability between the triangles and compare the variability between this and the variability between the red dots. And to do this, we compute sum of squares. So the sum of squares, we have listed the formulas here. They are not so important because the software estimates these sum of squares. But we have the total variation, which is the differences between the red dots and the grand mean, which is the horizontal line. So we sum the DWX square deviations for all here. The product, the sum of square for products is related to the difference between the triangles and the grand mean. And finally, the error is related to the differences between the dots and these triangles. So this is how we split the variability into different parts according to which source the variability comes from. These sum of squares splits this total variation into a product sum of squares and an error sum of squares. So the product sum of squares is the systematic part of the variation. So this is the variation between different levels of a factor or the treatment or between the different products. And this sum of square errors is the random part. So this is the variation within levels, and it's the different observations of the same product. So the mean sum of squares is the scaling of these sum of squares to make comparable quantities. So we divide by what we call degrees of freedom. And for the one-way ANOVA, the degrees of freedom are related to how many groups you have and how many observations you have. So for the product, it will be the number of products or groups minus one. And for the error, it's the number of observations, the total number of observations between the total number of groups. So it's n minus I. And the total is the number of observations minus one. So it's n minus one. So the mean squares are simply the sum of squares divided by the degrees of freedom. When we have these mean sum of squares, we can compute what we call the F statistics. And it's very nice to have these F statistics compared to just the ratio of the sum of squares, because this have a known distribution. So when we have an F statistic, we can look up a p-value using a table or some software. And you can get the p-value, which says something about the probability of getting a larger f-statistics if you don't have any difference between your products. So this f-statistics is kind of the measure on if the spread between these triangles or the product means are larger than the spread between the dots within the groups. We really compare these sum of squares through these F statistics. So this illustration on the right hand side, if you have sample means are all close, you get a small F statistic. So the F will be in this non-shaded area, and you will get a high p-value, and you will not say that you have a difference between the products. If you have a large F statistics, you have the F statistics in this shaded area, and you will get the small p-value. And then you will reject the hypothesis that you have no differences between the products, and you will investigate further to find out which of the products are different. So this F statistics is the ratio of the variance contributions, and the larger the F value is, the more differences or the more part of the variation is caused by the systematic part or these different products or treatments. So the model we use in the one-way ANOVA is that you have a response value, for instance, liking. And you have the grand mean, which is the mu, and you have the product effect, which is the alpha, and you have the random variation or the residual, which is assumed to have a normal distribution with expectation zero and variance sigma. yeah, so here are these symbols explained. The interpretation here is that this mi and the alpha are parameters. And these parameters are estimated by fitting the model to the data. And this alpha, they represent the deviation from the overall mean due to this product effect. So if it's positive, you have analyze liking, for instance, the product is more liked than the overall average, whereas if it's negative, it's less liked than the overall average. So when we come to the hypothesis testing, the null hypothesis is that you don't have any product differences, so that the product means are the same. So it is written like all the alphas are equal and equal to zero. So you don't have any deviations from the grand mean. The H1 is the alternative hypothesis, that you have a difference. And at least one of these are different. So to perform this test, you compute these F statistics and you look up the p-value. And if this p-value is smaller than your chosen significance level, then at least one of the product means are different. And this p-value, this is the probability of getting a larger F statistics if your null hypothesis is true. So this means that if you have a low p-value, it is very unlikely that you will get a larger f-statistic if there is really a difference. And if this, if you don't have a very low p-value, you don't reject the null hypothesis. But if it's very low, you will reject. What you should be aware of is that this null hypothesis also include your mathematical model. So these assumptions that I mentioned first, that is also a part of your null hypothesis. So if you get a really low p-value, it can also mean that these assumptions are wrong. If you kind of are into a situation where your decision is very critical, it's important to investigate residuals and so on to really check that your assumptions are correct. I will not go into details on how to do that today because it's too much to have it in one lecture. So when you have done this, you get this one-way ANOVA table. So here is an example where you have the source, which is the sources of variation. And in the one-way, you will have only the product and the residuals. And in it, the softwares are a bit different. So here you only have products and residuals or the error, but sometimes you also get the total in the ANOVA table. And you will have the degrees of freedom, the sum of squares, the mean sum of squares, and the F statistics, and finally the p-value. So in this case, it's not really a significant difference between the products. The post-hoc testing is about finding out which samples or which products are different. So the ANOVA answer the questions, are there product differences? But if you want to know which products are different, you need to go into so-called post-hoc testing, which could be either pairwise comparisons or compare with a control. So pairwise comparisons is like you compare everything, all pairs, and compare with a control is typically if you have a reference or like if you want to do kind of a comparison with the best in the market, or if you have done some small adjustments on a recipe, you want to know if it's kind of different from the old version or something like that. Planned contrasts are should be defined before you start to do any experiment, and your design of experiment should be made to make this planned contrast. So comparing with a control is one type of planned contrasts, but you can also have other types of planned contrast. It could be like if you have let's say you compare some varieties of a vegetable and you want to compare two different geographical regions, then you could kind of compare the average for all varieties from one region compared to another regions. So this is what we call planned comparison. But your design of experiment should be made prior should be made according to what things you want to compare. And the planned contrasts are more powerful than making all pairwise comparisons. But the main difference is that you decide before you start an experiment that what you want to compare. When we do the postdoc testing with pairwise comparisons and comparing with a control, we get into a problem of multiple testing. So as mentioned, the p-value is the probability of observing a test statistic for a one-way ANOVA, that is the F value, larger than you have in your data set. So if the H, the null hypothesis is correct, the p-value is the chance of observing a larger difference between means in new data if there are no differences. And the significant level, the alpha, is the probability of doing a type 1 error. And a type 1 error is to reject your null hypothesis and claim a difference when there is not. So this is also called a false discovery. So if you choose to have a significance level of 0.01, you will by chance do a type 1 error one of 100 times. So when you do many tests, you will increase the chance of doing a false discovery or a type 1 error. So this is why we need to adjust the p-value to account for this when we do multiple tests. So an example, if you have 8 products and you do pairwise comparisons, you will have 28 comparisons. And then if you have a significant level of 0.101 in each of the tests, for the whole test, you will then have, or for all the different comparisons, you will have 0.28 chance, or that is 28% chance of doing a false discovery. So this is why it's important to do this multiple testing adjustments. So there are different strategies for doing this. Some of the strategies control what we call the family-wise error rate, whereas others control the false discovery rate. I just mentioned this here. I will not go into these details. I will only mention some methods for how to adjust these p-values. And for pairwise comparisons, I will advise to use the Tukey HSD. In some software, it's only called Tukey. So this HSD stands for honestly significant difference. Other alternatives are the Fisher's least significant difference, the Student-Neumann-Coilt test, and also others. But for the pairwise comparisons, it's advisable to use the Tukey adjustments. If you have comparisons with a control, I would advise to use what we call a Dunnett's test. These different methods differ a bit in kind of how conservative they are. And there's kind of no real rule for what is optimal, because this depends a bit on how large the differences really are and the variability and so on. But this Tukey is kind of safe in most situations. Yeah, so now we come to the ANOVA for the preference data. So far, I have discussed only the one-way ANOVA, where you kind of have only one sources of variation, which is kind of the product or a treatment. When we have preference data, we also have the consumer effects. So here we have the liking, we have the grand mean, and we have the product, and we have the consumer effect, and we have the random error. So this model is also referred to as a repeated measurement model. And this is because we have these consumers. If you have tested, let's say, 5 products, you have 5 measurements for each product, for each consumer. And we can expect that the answers from one consumer will be correlated. And this is why we need to include this consumer effect. So in this model, we have the product effect, which is a fixed effect. And as before, this is related to how much the product number Y deviate from the overall mean. And for each product or each level of our factor, we will get an estimated coefficient and also a standard error, which says something about the uncertainty of this estimate. The consumer effect, which is sometimes also called a subject effect, is what we call a random effect. So this captures the variation between the consumers. We say it's a random effect because we are not concerned with the effect of the consumer. We are not interested if the if consumer number 10 is have a higher liking than consumer number 23, but we want to include the consumer effect to adjust for this, but we are not really interested in the effect. And a consumer or subject effect should always be included when each consumer or subject have responded to more than one item more than one time. And as before, this final term is the random error. So this is all the variation not included in the model, and is the non-systematic part of the variation. So this model can be used in 2 different types of applications. So here on the left side is a typical situation in consumer science where you have 3 different products, here illustrated with chocolate cake, caramel cake, and lemon cake. And you have a number of people that test each of these products. So all the subjects test all the different products. And then you can use this model. And another situation if you have only one type product or sample, but that you measure several times, so that you measure each consumer measure at different give their response at different time points. So then you don't have, like in the left situation, you have the treatment or the condition or the product, whereas in the right situation, you only have the time as the fixed factor. So the time will go into the alpha effect, and the subject or consumer will go into the delta effect. So, brief about conjoint analysis. This is when we want to investigate simultaneous effect of several product attributes on liking. We can have rating based, that is when the consumers answer on typically 1 to 7 scale, or a ranking based or a choice based conjoint study. The rating based conjoint studies can be analyzed using ANOVA. So often you have extrinsic attributes like brands, packaging, price, and so on, but it can also involve testing. In some situations, you also want to include different types of consumer factors. So if you do conjoint, you extend these basic models that I presented. So you can, instead of having the product term, you have different effects for the different factors that you have on your product. And the consumer term can be extended with different effects for consumer factors. And if you have this, you should have a nesting structure on the consumer factor.
Ingun, yes? there has been a comment on the chat that you are a bit too fast speaking.
Okay.
I'm also thinking that maybe it can help if you point with the cursor. Where are you on the slide? I think we can see it.
Okay.
If you point with your cursor.
Somebody have a lot of noise here now. There's some really noise on the. Yeah. So can everybody mute? Yeah. Thank you. Yes. Mute all. Okay, so now I have muted everybody. Thank you for Paola for letting me know. I thought you could see my cursor, so
no, we don't see it. That's strange.
Okay. Yeah, I think this has to do with how the presentation is shared. Yeah. Okay, I'm sorry that it's a bit fast, but there will be repetition of this when we go into the consumer check. Yes. So, for the rest, I will try to speak a bit slower, most things will be repeated when we go into the consumer check and look more into the practicalities. Yes. Okay, so there is one hand raised. Okay. So it's Kvabena. Have her hand raised, so I can have one question now. No. So there is one. No, yeah. So this P. Kvabena will not give a question, so I think I will continue. Yes, so I will continue. I will go one step back to repeat, since there was comments that it's a bit fast. So this model is what we use if we have, for instance, liking data, and we have a set of consumers, and all consumers have tasted all products. So the product effect is represented by this alpha, and the consumer effect is represented by this delta. The same model can be applied if we have only one product or one treatment, but that the consumers respond to this product at different time points. And then it's the time that go in as this alpha, and the delta is still the product, still the consumer effect. And the epsilon, the last part, is the random error. And conjoint analysis is when we want to know about several products, several product attributes at the same time. So instead of having only a product effect, we include other factors, which could be extrinsic attributes like brand, packaging, price, or it could also be different product factors related to how the products are made. And it can involve tasting, or it can only be that the consumers are presented like prototypes or images of the products. Conjoint can be done with rating, ranking, or as a choice based. And if you have done a rating based ANOVA, which is when the consumers give their response on typically a 1 to 7 scale, you can use ANOVA for analyzing the results. If you have a ranking based or a choice based conjoint, you need to use other methods. And this rating based conjoint ANOVA can be analyzed with the consumer check. So that is why I have included it here. And if you have this, you extend the model that was presented on the previous slide. So you, instead of having a product effect, you have effects for each of the factors included in the model. If you have consumer effects, you can extend this consumer term with different consumer factors. And we also use what we call a nesting structure. So we have, if you, for instance, have a consumer factor as gender, we include this as consumer within gender. So this is explained in more detail here. We had the basic model with the product effect and the consumer effect. Instead of this alpha, we now have the product effects with two factors, which are labeled by beta and the gamma, and a two-way interaction. So these terms are fixed and will give more information about which attributes of the product will have an effect on liking. Here we have a consumer effect. So this delta is extended with the interactions between the product effects and the consumer effects. So all these effects in this gray triangle are random factors because we multiply the random delta with other factors. So again, we are not really interested in this, it's in the different levels here. It's more to account for different parts of variations. We can also add consumer factors, which is sometimes also called a priori segmentation. And now we have back to the same product effect, and we have consumer factors here. For instance, this could be gender, it could be an age group, or it could be if you have some other socio-demographic variables. So this is expressed with this lambda. And you have a main effect of the lambda, and you have an interaction between the product and the lambda. And here is what I mentioned before, that the consumer effect, the subject effect, is now within gender or within this consumer factor. And this is because the consumers can only belong to one group. So when you come into to the practicalities of analyzing, you don't really need to know all these models. It's more to know about the principles or what these different terms mean. So this was where I was thinking to have a short break. If there are questions, we can have some questions now. There is still a hand raised on Kwabena P. So if you have a question, you can ask the question now.
I have tried to lower it, Ingun, but cannot make it.
Okay.
So maybe it's something about the settings of the meeting that you can only do it yourself.
I don't really know. Yeah, I can do, yes. Okay. But
I guess maybe people will ask questions after the more practical part.
There is someone raised hand now. It's a bit difficult because a lot of the participants are only guests, So I think it's better that if you have a question, you write it in the chat, and we can read the question aloud. Okay, so I have muted all now. So I think we will have a 15-minute break. So we will start again at 10:55. And you can write questions in the chat. Yes, so we will have a short break, and we will continue later. And it's a lot of information, but I hope things will be clearer when we do some practical exercises later. Yes, we are getting close to start again. If you have not downloaded the consumer check yet, I remind you to do that. We will also have one more day before we start the consumer check, so you will have one more option. I'm sorry that I have to always tell you to mute, and it's because it's really disturbing to have these sounds directly into the air. Yes, so now it's 10:55, so I will start the lecture again. I will try to look as fast as before. So to recap a bit, the ANOVA is about splitting the variability into different parts. So we split the variability according to different products or different product factors like the fat content, sugar content, or something like that. When we do ANOVA on consumer data, we also include a consumer effect. And the consumer effect is a random factor. And I will talk more now in this part about what is a random and what is a fixed factor. Now we now get into the ANOVA for sensory descriptive analysis, and it's basically the same principles as when you analyze consumer data. But since we often have replication when you do a descriptive test, we can have some more effects in the models. So, as mentioned, I will say a bit more about fixed and random factors. So a fixed factor is when the experimental control or select the levels of interest. So if you do any study, if it's a consumer study or a sensory study, you select which products you want to include, or you select which product factors that you want to include, and you select the levels. So this is what you have control on. And the output from a fixed factor is related to the average of the levels. So you're interested in comparing the means. If you have a factor with only two levels, it is also always fixed factor. So the fixed factors in a consumer study are typically the factors that you really are interested in. A random factor have many possible levels, and the experiment comprises only a random selection. So if you have a consumer study, you can have a lot of different consumers. So we have a sample from a population, and you are not really interested in these levels. And the output from the random factors are more related to the variance. And these factors are usually included to account for the variation. The levels themselves are not really that interesting. And I also mentioned before in some of the models listed before, that if you have an interaction between a random and a fixed factor, they are always considered as random. So if you have a sensory descriptive test, you will have the fixed factors would be the product factor. In some situations, you don't have just kind of product, you have factors on the product, but we now just keep to the situation where we have the product effect. And the random factors are the assessor effect and the product times the assessor effect, that is the interaction between the product and the assessor. In addition, you can have a replication effect, and you can have interactions between product and replication, and between the assessor and the replication. As you can see here, the product effect, the assessor effect, and the product times assessor effect is in bold, whereas the others are the normal font type. And this is because the replication effect is not always included. The effects in bold are always included, but not always the replication effects. So the replication you include if you have one session for each replication, so that if in the first session you have all from replicate one, and in the second session all from replicate two, and so on, or if you have a grouped collection of sessions for each replication, so that, for instance, session one and two is for the first replicate, and session three and four is for the second replicate. Yeah, and now I have put up three different models that can be applied for sensory analysis. And these three different models you will find in panel check, which we will not show today, but on the next lecture. And you will find them in these three tabs in this screenshot from panel check. So the one that is called two-way ANOVA, one replicate, is if you don't have replication, so we have only one presentation of the samples. So in this model, you have only the product and the assessor effect. And this is basically the same model that we use for consumer studies. So here it's, I see now that there is a mistake in this formula. So I will correct this before I send the presentations. So it should not be, it should be only YJ and not YJR. The next, which is mentioned as two-way ANOVA, is perhaps the most common, and this is where you have random replicates. So the replication is completely randomized, and then you can have the product effect, the assessor effect, and the interaction between the product and the assessor. And here the model is correct. We don't include the replication effect in this model because when they are randomized, you don't expect any systematic differences between the replicates. So you don't expect this to contribute anything beside the random variation. The three-way ANOVA is when you have the replicates in different sessions, or if you have one so that you have one session per replication or a grouped collection of sessions for each replication. And in that case, you have the product effect, you have the assessor effect, and you have a replicate effect, and you have the two-way interactions between these terms. So this is when you can expect that you have some systematic differences between these sessions or between these replications. So I will not go into more details on this now, because you will have a lot on this in the panel check lecture. And it's always when you want to know about the product, it's always this product effect you want to investigate further. But if you want to look into the panel performance, it's different assessor effect and the interactions with assessor and a product and a replicate. So here is a summary of the different models that we have discussed now, So on the left side, in the red or orange, we have ANOVA with only fixed factors, and on the right side we have different mixed models where we have both random and fixed factors. So the one-way ANOVA is when you have only the product effect, or more generally a treatment effect. For sensory data, this is if you look into the data for one assessor only. And if it's a consumer study, this is if you have the between group comparison, so that you have one set of consumers testing one product and a different set of consumers testing another product. So here you have only the product effect. if you have kind of the same situation with the between group study, but you don't have only the product, you have different factors for the product, you can have a two-way ANOVA. So in the lecture on design of experiments, I discussed the two-way treatment structure. So this is when you analyze this type of data and you don't have repeated measures or several responses from one consumer or assessor. The mixed model, you include a subject effect, which is the consumer if you have a consumer study, and then a trained assessor if you have a sensory descriptive analysis. So for if you have a one-way treatment, which is then only a product effect and a consumer and no replicates, you have a two-way ANOVA where you have the product effect and you have the consumer effect. And the product is fixed and the consumer is random. So this is typically what you use if you have this consumer monadic test. Yes, and then if you have a one-way treatment, so you still have only kind of product effects and you have assessors and you have replicates, so this is a typically sensory experiment. So the factors you have then is the product and the assessor and the interaction between product and assessor. And the product is fixed, whereas the other factors are random. And as mentioned, this is what you use if you have a sensory descriptive analysis. So now we change the theme a bit. We'll come back to the ANOVA part for consumer studies when we come into consumer check. And now we go into the multivariate analysis and principal component analysis, PCA. So PCA is kind of a cornerstone in multivariate analysis. And the principle of PCA is also relevant for PLS, partial least square regression, and for multi-block methods like multiple factor analysis and others. So all different multivariate methods are in some way very similar to PCA. So if you understand PCA, you can later go on to other methods if there's a need for that. So the basic idea of principal component analysis is that you have a data set with a lot of variables. This could, for instance, be liking, or it could be the average data from a sensory panel. So you have different products represented by the rows, and you have different sensory attributes on the columns, or you have the liking for different consumers on the columns. And instead of looking into this big table, you want to make a smaller set of variables, which we call components. And the scores are how the samples or the different products are represented on these variables. And the loadings are how the different variables, the original variables, contribute to the components. So here is an example shown for a sensory data set. So on the left side where it says scores plot, the different samples are shown for principal component 1 and 2. So instead of looking at a number of attributes, we look at two components that we call PC1 and PC2. So we compress this very multivariate data into a two-dimensional space. And the loading plot on the right-hand side shows how these variables contribute to these two new variables that we call components. So I will show more on this example later. But first we go more into the details. So here it's shown for some artificial data with three variables. And with these variables are called Y1, Y2, and Y3. And we have some data points lying in this three-dimensional space. So we have three variables. but these data are kind of mainly in a plane in this three-dimensional space. So we have three variables, but the information is really in this plane. So when we compress into the principal components, we can look into the scores, which are here in the upper right corner. And we have PC1 on the x-axis and PC2 on the y-axis. And we have all the different observations here as dots. So now, instead of looking into a three-dimensional space, we look into two dimensions. And to say anything about these components mean, we look into what we call loadings, which is the weight each variable have on these new components. And here we can say that this Y1 have a big contribution to component number one. Y2 is in the other direction of this component. And Y3 is the main contribution to the second dimension. So these score plots are interpreted in terms of these loadings plots. And there are two different ways of presenting the loadings. It's as here on the left side, or as a correlation loading that is presented in the bottom right corner. And the correlation loadings is the correlation between your original variable and the new variable, the principal component. And this circle is related to how much of the variance in the which is explained by the components. So the outer circle is 100% variation. So in this example, this Y3 is almost 100% explained by the components. The inner circle is related to the 50%. So any variables between the inner and outer circle would be explained by 50%, or 50% of the variation in the variable will be explained by the components. Whereas variables that are located within this inner circle is less than 50% will be explained by the principal components. Yes, so I will go back a bit, just a moment. The way these principal components are made is by Maxi. I see somebody ask about the pointer. I cannot find out how to use a pointer in the presentation. So I try to explain where I'm looking. I am sorry about this, but I don't know how to fix it. So the idea with the principal component analysis is that you compress the data into fewer variables, which we call principal components. And these variables are made in such a way that they will maximize the variability in your data. So you first find one component, which is a linear combination of your original variables, and this component maximizes the variability. So when the first component is found, the next is extracted, and it's extracted in such a way that it's orthogonal to the first component, and it maximizes the variation that is left in the data after the first component. And one explanation of the principal components is like if you have a banana shape, and if you put a stick into the banana in kind of the long direction of the banana, this will be the first principal component. And the second principal component will be orthogonal to the stick and in the bend shape of the banana. And if you do this, you can kind of present the three-dimensional banana into a two-dimensional space like a smile with these two axes. And for those that are interested in mathematical details, this is obtained by what we call a singular value decomposition. So here I go more into the example that was presented first. It's an example that you can find the references to on top of this slide. And there are 10 different samples. So this example is on cream cheese, and there are three different levels of fat, named by 16, 24, and 33%. And there is a prototype P and a prototype added aroma, which is labeled P aroma. And then there are some commercial samples, A, B, C, D, with either a protein-based fat replacement, which then have a prot after the letter, or a carbohydrate-based fat replacement with CHO after the letter. And the sample A prot is replicated, so the replicate is labeled A prot 2. So this is a sensory study, and so this is a PCA of the average of the sensory attributes that will be presented in the next slide. And what we can see from this plot is, first of all, that the two replicates of the same sample are very close to each other. They are really on top of each other in the bottom right corner of the sample of the plot, where you can see A prot and A prot 2. So this gives confidence in the data, because you can tell that this sensory panel managed to evaluate this sample the same way twice. It's not very easy to see, but here on the left side, just above the line, you have the P and the P aroma. They are so much on top of each other that you don't really see both of them. So this tells us in a very easy way that adding aroma does not make a big difference to this prototype. Furthermore, we can see that both of the commercial samples that have a protein-based fat replacement is in the lower right part of the score plot. So you have A prot and B prot in the same area. So by doing a PCA, you can summarize your data in a very fast way. And generally, it's that samples that are close together here, they are very similar, but those that are further away are not so similar. The loadings is how the variables are related to these principal components. Here, there are a lot of different sensory attributes, and you have some prefixes if the attribute is evaluated by nose, by eyes, by mouth, or by hand. So this is related to the different modalities and different ways of doing the sensory evaluation. And we can see here that on the right side, you can see that you have resistance firm and resistance by hand and resistance by mouth, and firm by mouth is far to the right. So these variables, these attributes contribute a lot to the first principal component, whereas the meltdown feeling in mouth and the visual appearance of shiny by eyes shiny is on the left side. So these are the attributes that contribute to this span along the first component. There are a lot of different attributes in different degrees contributing to the second axis, with mouth butter, mouth fat in the upper part, and mouth chalky, mouth sour, and eye white in the lower part. But the real power of this comes into play when we look at both of these plots at the same time. So now we can as mentioned, samples that are close are similar, whereas variables that are close have a high correlation. Variables that are on opposite sides of the origin have a negative correlation. So the variables on the right side is negatively correlated with variables far to the left side. And also we have a negative correlation if it's very low on the second axis and very high on the second axis. And furthermore, the purpose of looking at both plots together is that objects on the right side are dominated by variables on the right side and so on. So we have, for instance, M Chalky, which is in the bottom right corner of the loading plot. And in the same area for the scores plot, we have these A prot samples and partially also the B prot samples. So from this, we can deduce that this protein-based fat replacement gives some chalkiness and also sour and the other variables lying in this area. On the other side, in this upper part, we have the 33% fat sample, which is more characterized by butter and fat. The samples on the left side, which is the prototype with aroma and the lowest fat content, and this CCHO, is characterized mostly by the attributes on the left side, which is meltdown and e-shiny. When we talk about PCA, we also have to say something about standardization. So standardization is when you divide all variables with their standard deviation, so that after you do this, the standard deviation becomes one for all the variables. And if you do this, you give equal weight to all your variables or all your attributes. And in software, you can see sometimes that you can select to PCA by covariance, which is that you just use your data as is, or you can do standardization by the you can do PCA by the correlation matrix, which is to use the standardization. If you have heterogeneous variables, like you have different types of measurements, or if you have different scales on the variables, you have to do this standardization. Because if you, for instance, have some variables that are measured on a 1 to 7 scale and some on a 0 to 100 scale, these with a larger scale will contribute most to your principal components, regardless of everything else. For consumer and sensory data, it's a bit hard to say about standardization. If you have a trained panel, they should use the scale similarly. So if you then choose to use standardization, you will give an increased weight on attributes with a low intensity. So for trained panels, you should usually not do standardization, but it can be done. It's not wrong to do it, but you must be aware that then you will give more attention to attributes with low intensity. For consumer data, it's an open question because consumers tend to use scales differently. And if you have some consumers using the whole scale and some using only a small part of the scale, if you do a standardization, they will contribute similarly in a PCA. But then on the other hand, if a consumer uses a big part of the scale, it may be mean that he or she perceive more differences between the samples than a consumer that uses a small part of the scale. So if you should do standardization or not in PCA, it's an open question. And sometimes you should test both and see which makes a more sensible interpretation for your experiment. So now we come into preference mapping. So in preference mapping, we try to relate your preference data to other types of data. And the preference mapping is to relate the preference data with the sensory data. So your tools for doing this is to PCA and regression, and then we call it principal component regression, or you can do PLSR. And you can either regress the sensory data from the preference data or the other way around. And this is what we refer to as external or internal preference mapping, which I will explain more in detail later. If you have if you, on the other hand, have want to relate your preference data to a design of your samples, this is what we are into when we talk about conjoint analysis. And if you want to relate your preference data to different type of consumer factors, you are more into studying individual differences. And all these different parts can be combined. I see a question about percentage associated with principal component 1 and 2. So I forgot to say that. So I will go back a bit. So when you work with PCA, you need to consider the explained variability on the principal components. And when you present scores or loadings plots, you should look into how much explained variance is on these axes. And when you select the number of components to look at, you should look at how much explained variation is by each component. And ideally, you will see a breaking point, like you have a steady increase in the explained variability when you increase the number of components, and then you kind of get a breakpoint, and this explained variance will flatten out. With sensory data, you typically see this quite clearly, but for consumer data, it's very difficult to find the kind of optimal number of components, which we'll see later in the practical sessions. Yeah, so now we come into the preference mapping, and here we have the difference between the internal and external preference mapping. So internal preference mapping is when you use the preference data, the consumer data, as the X or the explanatory variables, and the sensory data as the Y. So you do a regression with the consumer data as X and the sensory data as Y. So if you do what we call PCR, principal component regression, you do first principal component analysis of the liking. You use these scores as the X, and you use the sensory attributes as the Y. So the consumer loadings you get from the PCA, and what we call the sensory loadings you get from these regression coefficients. Alternatively, you can use these, use PLS. Very often, PCR and PLS will give very similar results. In external preference mapping, you do it the other way around. So we have the sensory data as X and the consumer data as Y. And with PCR, you do the principal component analysis on the sensory data. Then you use the scores as the X data. And then you have your consumer liking as Y. And I have put here in parentheses that you can use ideal or vector model. I will not go into details on this, but here you have the scores as the X. So if you have the vector model, you just assume that the more of an attribute, the better it is liked. So you have only a linear effect in your regression model. If you have what we call an ideal model, you think about that you kind of, the liking will increase with the intensity of an attribute or this score, but then it will decrease. So you kind of have a maximum or a minimum somewhere. So you have additional terms in the model to account for nonlinear effects. In the consumer check, it's only the vector model that is considered. So the sensory loadings we get from the first PCA, whereas the consumer loadings are the regression coefficients. So also here, we can use PLS as an alternative. So with internal preference mapping, this is with an examples on apples that is presented, that is a part of this example data with the consumer check. So here on the left side, we have the score plot and the loading spot. So the score plot shows the samples. Here it's 5 different samples. And the loading plot shows the consumers. So here we have done a PCA on the liking data from the consumers. And here we show the different attributes, how they relate to these principal components. So these plots are generated in ConsumerCheck. It's not very easy to see the names of the attributes here. It's anonymized, so it's just called attribute 1, 2 to 10. And we see that we have an overload of consumers on the right-hand side. So if we look at the lower left plot, we see that there are more consumers on the positive side of the first axis. And also we see kind of more the same in the plot with red and blue. So this tells us that the majority of the consumers prefer the products that are on the right side. Which are I cannot really see on my screen the labels of these products, but it's the product on the right side which is the most preferred. And we see at the plot showing the consumers, we see that in this left lower left plot, we see there are very few consumers in the lower quadrant, the lower left quadrant. And we also see this in the red and blue plot. So this product 1 is not very liked by any of the consumers. So this is how we interpret this internal preference mapping. These plots will be seen again when we come into consumer check. So this is the external preference mapping. So this is the same data, but now we have shifted what is X and what is Y. Now we have the sensory as the X and the liking as the Y. And here we, on the left side, we see the scores and loading plot from the PCA on the sensory data. So we see that product 3 and 5, if we look at the lower part here, product 3 and 5 are very close to each other. And product 1 and 2 are very close to each other. And product 4 is a bit by itself. So this is quite interesting because we see that in this sensory analysis, some products are perceived as very similar, whereas the consumers have different liking of these products. And it's the attributes here on the right side which characterizes these two products. And the attributes that are in the upper part of the loadings plot characterize this product 4. Yeah, so we will talk more about this example when we come into consumer check. Sometimes preference mapping give these type of contour plots. This is not an option in consumer check, so this plot is made in Excel stat. And here you get this coloring. Instead of having these dots, you get a color which represent here the percentage of consumers which have a preference above the average in a given region. So in the upper part here, it's orange. And this says that we have 70 to 80% of the consumers in this area have a higher average liking have a, the average is higher for most consumers here, whereas in this blue region it's not. So this is just a different way of presenting the results instead of having more like these dots plots. Yes. Here are some examples from internal preference mapping with four different data sets. And these are included to show different ways of presenting. So in the previous, we had either this contour plot or we have these dot plots, but here they are shown as lines. And we can see that the plots look very different if you have a data set with a large number of consumers, as on the left side, or with a smaller number of consumers, as on the right side. And in particular, if we look at the upper and lower plots on the right side, we can see that here in the upper part, we have arrows going to all directions, which means that we don't have there are a lot of individual differences between the consumers. Some like the products that will be on the right side in the corresponding score plots, whereas others like the ones on the left side. So it's not really easy to say where the majority of the consumers are. So it will not be so easy to identify drivers of liking. On the lower part, on the other hand, almost all the arrows go to the right side, so then it's easy to see that it's the products that will be on that side which is most liked. So before we go into consumer tech, I just wanted to list that there are different options for open source free software. So we have consumer check that will be demonstrated later. So this is when you have some preference data. It's very easy to use. So you can do ANOVA or conjoint analysis. You can do PCA and you can do preference mapping. There are some options for investigating individual differences, but these are not very far developed. The program is not very flexible, which means that it's not bad. It's just that you have these kind of standard analysis that you can do, but you cannot do other types of analysis. And you need to have the data in very kind of correct format when you do the data import, and you cannot adjust and edit on the plots. The panel check you will have a lecture on later, and this is for sensory descriptive data, and it's ANOVA and different ways of investigating panel performance. And this panel check includes all different models you need for the standard sensory descriptive analysis and to do panel performance investigation. If you have a need to do more advanced models or that you deal with other types of data, not data that are relevant for consumer check or panel check, the open source options are R and Python. These tools are very flexible. They have many tools for graphics. You can use different types of models and different types of analysis. And you have different types of add-on packages or libraries. But to use these methods, you need to kind of understand and make program scripts. So I will, if you do daily type of data analysis with different types of data, that you don't always have the same set, that you have a lot of different types of data, which is not relevant for consumer check or panel check, and you do it often, you should try to learn these tools because it gives a lot of different options. So I have listed here some useful packages that are in R. And of course, there are a lot of softwares you can pay for, and the software you pay for are often more easy to use than this open source free software because you have support and so on. But of course, they cost money, and I have not mentioned them here because it can be a bit wrong to mention some and not the others. So now we will go into consumer check. I will say a bit about the example data and the import. And then we will have a short break, and those who have not downloaded the consumer check can do that during the break. So on the website for consumer check, you can find some example data. They are named data 1, ham and apples. I will illustrate mostly with the ham data and the apples data. So for the ham data, you can do basic statistics from the preferences, and you can do PCA, and you can do conjoint. For the apples data, you can do the basic statistics, PCA, and preference mapping. If you have some data on your own, you can try to analyze that during the exercises. But you really need to follow the format of the examples, otherwise you will have problems with importing the data. So here are some requirements for the data. So everything should be organized as two-way data matrices. That is a table with rows and columns. And you need to have as a separator either comma, space, or semicolon. You cannot have any, you may have column names and row names. It's not really needed, but when you get the plots, it's so much easier if you have row names and column names that are meaningful for you. And you can only have numerical values in the data. So if you, for instance, have a categorical variable which is labeled low and high, you need to change this to, for instance, -1 and 1, or 1 and 2, or 0, 1, or something like that. The software does not handle non-English characters in row and column names. This is a problem in Norway sometimes, because we have some letters that are not present in the English language. So we cannot have this type of letters when we import the data. The format could be either a TXT file or an Excel file. If you have some comments or information that is not visible in Excel, this will cause problems when you import into consumer check. So you should be aware of this. You can include some extra variables that you can use for visualization in the plots in consumer check. So you can, for instance, include some categories for the products. So you have one in this data set, you should have one column that defines the product. And if you want to kind of include some extra information on this product, you can include as additional columns that starts with an underscore. So the column name could, for instance, be brand, and then you can have an ID for each product if it's a brand or not. And the same for the consumer characteristics. So you will show, you will see more of this later. And the blue box here shows which type of tags you can put on your data. So it's not compulsory, but it's really useful. And often the consumer check will kind of select based on the data what type of data you have. So you can tag as a descriptive analysis, or as consumer liking, or as consumer characteristics, or as product design, or as other. So descriptive analysis is if you have the descriptive analysis, of course, and consumer liking if you have consumer data. So in both of these, the rows will represent products, and for the sensory, the columns will represent attributes. And for the consumer liking, the columns will represent consumers. in the, if you have a data on consumer characteristics, you have the rows representing the consumers and you have different columns representing characteristics like gender, age, and so on. And if you have data for product design, you also have rows representing the products and you have the different columns as design variables. So now we will try to show the consumer check online, but in the next slides there are different screenshots from the consumer check. So I will not go into the next slides in this talk, but when you get the presentation, you have the slides there, which shows a bit on how to use consumer check. So then I stop the presentation. And we will do a short break before we start with consumer check. And before we have the break, you can ask some questions if you want to. But as before, it's a bit difficult with the hands raised because there are a lot of really strange names here. It's like guest and there are a lot of slashes and everything. So I would prefer that if you have a question that you write in the chat. There is one hand raised that I think you can try to speak. Okay, I see there are some a lot of messages here. Yes, I see there are some people that have problems with installing the software. You get a strange kind of, if you have Windows, you get this message that it's some danger. That is some risks related to installing the software, but you can just kind of ignore that because it is a safe software to install and it will not harm your computer in any way. I also see that some have said that they had to do something with the antivirus software. Yeah, so I think I will take a break and we will start at 12. When we start again at 12, I will first demonstrate a bit on how to do things in consumer check. And then you can try yourself afterwards. And after a while, we will have some questions and answers if needed. Yes, it's now 12, so we'll start again and try to demonstrate the use of consumer check. So I will now share the screen with the consumer check. No, this was wrong sharing. Sorry. Here. Now, I hope everybody can see the consumer check screen. So, please let me know if you don't see it. So here I have imported the data sets from the website. And this is done by first clicking at the file. And before I continue, I would assume that for some of you, the text on the screen is a bit small. Unfortunately, it's not possible to increase the text size within Consumer Check. So one option you can do if it's small is perhaps to, if you have a laptop, and you put two fingers on this pad and kind of take the fingers apart from each other, then what you see in my shared screen will increase. At least it works as this for my computer, so I think it will work for others too. Well, so back to the import of data, you will go into the file menu and then add the data set. And then you choose the data sets that you want to import. So I have done this now, and we will start with looking at the Apple data sets. So we first look into the descriptive analysis, and here it says it's with categories. And this is what I mentioned, that we first have the product labels here, product 1 to 5, and we have attribute 1 to 14. And in the end, we have different categorical variables describing the data. And if you have your own describing the products, so if you have your own data and have some additional attributes like this, the column names should have this underscore before. The underscore is not shown here, but if you look into the raw data file, this column starts with an underscore. And the variables you include here would typically be the variables in your design matrix for the products. We have the liking data. So here we also have the products in the product labels in the first column, and we have the liking for the different consumers. And here we have the similar categorical variables to describe the products. And also here they are in the data file that you put into consumer check, these columns starts with an underscore. So now we can first do a PCA on this data. I want to do a PCA on the sensory data, so I select Apple's descriptive analysis with categories, and to look into the results I just click here, and I first get an overview plot. So in the so now I will see if it's possible to have this to have this cursor. No, I cannot find it. Yeah, so in the upper left, you see the scores, and then in the upper right, you have the loadings. And in the bottom part, you have the correlation loadings and the explained variance. I can try to increase like this. And if you look at the explained variance first, this is what I talk about, that you should look for a breakpoint in the curve of this explained variance. And you see two lines, one is labeled calibrated and one is labeled validated. The validation is done by cross-validation. So it looks into what happens if you take out one sample at a time. And we see here that one component explains almost 90% of the variability, and you get 9 additional percent explained with two components. So here it's almost a component thing, and that this attribute 14 stands for a lot of the variation. And we see, as mentioned before, that product 1 and 2 are very similar, and product 3 and 5 are very similar, and product 4 is here in the upper corner. So these products 3 and 5 on the right hand side, they are characterized by attribute 14. Product 4 is characterized by these attributes that are in the upper part of the loadings plot. So attribute 1, attribute 2, attribute 12, and so on. Whereas product 1 and 2 are characterized by attribute 5 and 10, which are in the lower part of the loadings plot. The correlation loading plots look a bit different from the loading plot. So here we see how the original variables correlate with the principal components. In the loading plot, typically the attributes with a high intensity will have a higher contribution than attributes with a small intensity. And also if you have so this is more it's useful to look at both the correlation loadings and the loadings because they tell a bit different story. So we can, for instance, look at this attribute 5 and 10. They are in the lower part of the loadings plot, and they are also in the lower part of the correlation loadings. And they are in the loadings plot, they are much closer to the center than, for instance, attribute 14. But they are as well explained by the PCA model as attribute 14. But the loading plots that attribute 14 contribute more to the model, but the correlation loadings tell that they are similarly explained. So if you want to use this overview plot in a report or a presentation or something, you can save it by clicking on this camera. And the default location will be under the program files. So you will kind of, if you want to save in a different location, you use this, the common way of saving. And if you have used the program before, you can have a shortcut to different locations here. But it should be straightforward how to save this data. And you can save as a PNG. And this can be used in many different applications. And all the plots in ConsumerCheck you can save by clicking this photo camera. So this was the overview plot. If you want to look more into details, you can look into the score plots separately. And now if you want to look into more components, you can use the arrows. So these horizontal arrows control which component you look into on the first axis, and the vertical arrows control which components you look into on the vertical axis. Yeah, so horizontal and vertical. So now we look into component 1 and 2. And if I want to have component 3 on the second axis, I do like this. So here the component 3 explains only 1% of the variability, so it's not very useful to look at. If you click here, you get equal scale axis. I go back to, so we have PC1 and PC2. So here now, you see that the scale here is takes more into consideration that the first component explains a lot more of the variation. So it's often a better interpretation if you look into the equal scale. You can also choose to not show the labels. Sorry, I clicked the wrong place. To not show the labels. And now you can see these additional variables that were in the end of the data set. We had 3 different categorical variables in the end, and we can color the products according to this. So this can be rather helpful. Yes, so I'll go back to this first one. You see now that I have tried different things. This become a bit kind of overloaded with the legend here. So if you select different things, you maybe have to close and go back again. But this can be, these categories for this data set is made a bit artificial. But it can be very useful if you want to investigate more, like the different brands or the different packaging or whatever differs the products you are investigating. So now if you can also look at the scores numerically by clicking at this view result table. So here you get the actual scores, and you also get these same categorical variables as you had in your data set. So if you want to use this data further in some type of analysis, you can copy to the clipboard and, for instance, paste into Excel or a text file and save it for later. So now if you click the next plot, you get to the loading plot. Another way of getting into the loading plot is to click here, and so you get the same plot. And here it's the same thing as before. You can use the arrows to change which components you look into. You can select this equal scale. And here we don't have any options to color the subsets because we don't have that for the attributes. And if you now click on the next, we get into the correlation loadings, which are the same as we had in the overview plot. And if we select next again, we look into the explain variance. So we first get the overview plot, and then we can look into details of the different plots. So this was an example of PCA on descriptive analysis. So now we can select to use on consumer data. So we will select the ham consumer liking. So as before, we see the overview. And here you see that compared with, I will go into the, so here you have the explained variance. And in contrast to the descriptive analysis, we have much more deviation between the calibrated and validated. And this is typical because the consumers are less there's more variation with the consumer data than as sensory data. And you see that you don't really get a very clear benchmark or breakpoint on the number of components for the calibration, but the validation here indicates that maybe you can look into 3 components, but with not many samples, it's more natural maybe to keep in 2 components. And I showed previously that you can use next plot, but you can also use the previous plot. So here you see the consumer loadings, and here you have the different products. So this is a different data set, and now we see we have more products, and we see we have kind of 3 groups of products. Yes. Yeah, so this was the PCA. Now we can go into basic liking. So the basic statistics for liking. So we look into the consumer, the ham consumer liking again. And you can look into plots for all products. So you can get this box plot for the liking. Or you can look into this stacked histogram where each color says something out about the percentage answering 1, 2, 3 and up to 9 on this scale. So this is to get a nice overview of your data. And here it's the same as before, that you can save the plot by looking into the camera, or you can look into the numericals by selecting the result table. And if you tick percentage, you have the percentage of consumers on the y-axis. Otherwise, you have the counts. So that was for all the products at the same time. You can also look into single products. For instance, product 4, you had 16% rated 1, 7% rated 2, and so on. And here, if you go into previous and next, you can shift between the different products. So now, if we want to do an ANOVA to investigate if there are significant differences between these products, we go into this tab called Conjoint. We have the ham design. And in this ham design, we have product and information as design variables. Today, I will only use the product. So this was a design where you had 4 different levels on the product and 2 different levels on the information, but we will pretend that it's 4 different products only. And if you have kind of the typical situation where you only have the product effect, you need to make a design matrix which says product 1, 2, 5, for instance, and just have 1 to 5 in this column. We don't include any consumer characteristics here, and we select the ham consumer liking. If you do a mistake and select apples liking instead, you get this alignment mismatch warning, because in the design matrix we have 8 rows, and in this liking matrix we have 5 different rows. So it tells like here is something wrong. So we get some help from the software, because you need to kind of have the same data set. So now we can look into these results. We can look into the fixed effects. So now I get on my screen, it's not shown on your screen, but it comes this additional window, which says that the conjoint calculation status. So when the calculation is ended, I just click OK on this. And now we get the results into the table. And you see this table looks very small because we only have this product effect. So we see the sum of squares, the mean sum of square, the F statistics, the degrees of freedom for the denominator. So the F statistics in the end, and you have the different degrees of freedom for different terms, and you have the p-value in the end. And this can also be copied to the clipboard. You can get some results for the random effects, and this is the consumer effect. And you can get the pairwise differences. And here you see that the p-value is adjusted. You have a raw p-value and you have an adjusted p-value. So we have an estimate for the difference and a standard error for the difference. And here you get the t-statistics and you'll get confidence intervals. So you can also look into the product effects. So here we see which products are best liked and least liked. And here you see a yellow frame around this plot, which indicate that the p-value is smaller than 0.05. If it will be smaller, it will be kind of orange or even red. And if it's not significant, it's gray. And if you have more effects here, you will get one effect for each of the main effects, and you will get the plot for interactions. But here we don't have any interactions because we had only the product effect. So if you recall from the lecture that we had this basic model where you have the alpha and the consumer effect, so that is what we include here. If we include two variables here, it would be more like the situation where we have these extensions on the product effect with different factors to describe the product. So now I will show a bit on the preference mapping. So here we select one data set for the liking. So we do the apples here, and we select one data for the sensory, and we select also apples here, so we have the same products. And we can select if you want to do internal or external. So I select external, and we can select PSR or PCR. So I select PCR. Usually there is very small differences on PSR or PCR. And if you do internal or external, depends a bit on how you want to kind of angle your data. So as before, you get the overview plot. So this is basically first the PCA of, I will go into this more details plot because it's easy to see for you. So here you get first the score plot, which is the same as we obtained with the PCA on the sensory data. And here we get the explained variance for the sensory data and the explained variance for the consumer data. So this first component for the sensory explain 38% of the liking. And here we see both the sensory loadings and the consumer loadings. And here it can be useful to unselect on show consumer labels, because then we get kind of a bit cleaner picture. And we see here that we have some attributes here on the right side, 14, 11, 13, and 9. And we have some attributes here in the top. So these, as explained before, these attributes here on the right side characterize the products that are here on the right side. Here we can, if we want to, do segmentation. So we can click this number of segments, and the segmentation is obtained by splitting according to the quadrants of the plot. If we want to have more segment, we move this bar. Or we can select a number in this box on the right side. So now I've selected 8. It's a bit unnatural to have 8 segments with such a small data set. So this is just to show how you can use it. And you can look into a result table where you have the loadings for the sensory attributes. Okay. And you will get similar results if you do internal preference mapping or if you do external. The main difference is kind of what you put as X and what you put as Y. The final thing I wanted to show, or I think I will skip to show it because I think it's better you have some time to try yourself, but you have this tab with individual differences, which has some additional options, but I think we skip that today. So now I will stop sharing the screen. And I see there are some things in the chat. Yeah, so there are one person have asked that the p-value and the adjusted p-value look different. Why? Yes, so this is the p-value the p-value, this was the table with the pairwise comparisons for the ANOVA, and when you do these pairwise comparisons, it's actually a t-test for each of the pairs. So the ANOVA showed that you have that significant difference between products, and then you want to check which products are different. And then it's a pairwise comparison, and then you compare two things, so you get into a t-test. And you get a p-value for each of the comparisons. But since you then do a lot of tests, the p-value is adjusted according to this Tukey AHD procedure. And then it gets a bit higher. So that's why you have a difference between the p-value and the adjusted p-value. So I will mute my microphone, and I encourage you to have a go at consumer check and try the type of analysis that is most interesting for you if you want to try ANOVA or if you want to try the PCA or the preference mapping. And if you have problems, I will try to answer. Yes, so yes, so this there is a question from Medium here, and this is kind of a technical error, so I have really no clue what this error message means. So Miriam, is this one of the data sets that were with the downloaded from Consumer Check, or is it some? Okay, so which data set is it? Hmm.